Hello and welcome to the LA Venture Podcast. We're David Waxman and Minnie Ingersoll, partners and investors at TenOneTen.
Great. Eric, we're really thrilled that you're here in my dad's office at Caltech. Thanks for coming on the pod.
It's my pleasure. Always thrilled to go to Caltech.
So. Great. So Eric is the president of Tech Coast Angels and also formerly the president CEO of the 99 Cents Only stores. Did I get that right?
Perfect.
Great. So I'm hoping to ask you both about Tech Coast Angels, but also some about 99 Cents Only stores because it's a big part of your background and something I know very little about.
Okay.
Great.
Go right ahead.
Okay.
I'd love for you to start with just a little background on who you are and TCA.
Sure. So I started out as an engineer, got an MBA, got into venture capital, and was transferred to LA back in 1987. So was a VC out here for several years. And VC then was a lot different than it is now. In fact, we used to have to travel away from LA to go to visit almost all the companies. Mm. Anyway, met my wife on a blind date, and why that has anything to do with my career is that her parents started 99 Cents Only stores with one little store back in 1982. And in 1991, they were nice enough to give me a job. So I joined 99 Cents Only stores then. We had a small number of stores, and we just had a great growth story. We went public in the New York Stock Exchange in 1996, and I became president and CEO, and we took the company private in 2012 with a well-known private equity firm, stayed on for a year, and then in 2013, I left. The whole family left, but I joined Tech Coast Angels in about 5 years ago, became the president of Tech Coast Angels a couple of years ago, and TCA has five chapters. LA is one of the biggest ones, and there's several hundred members throughout Southern California. It's been around for 20-something years, and you know, they invest a lot of money. Each member puts in a check. And each chapter kind of has kind of a different area of expertise. I would say in LA, we have a lot of folks with consumer and entertainment experience and aerospace and experience and now e-commerce experience. San Diego has a lot of biotech experience. And we share deals among ourselves. And the other interesting thing I'll say about TCA is that in addition to getting a lot of investors who can add value for the specific areas of expertise, we are in the process of creating our own fund as well, like a VC fund. And we had our first closing yesterday.
Congratulations.
Yeah,
congratulations.
And we raised enough that we don't have to give back money. So yeah, we were very happy, and we hope to hit $1 million. And then our goal is to raise the fund each year from members so we can write a big check in addition to members writing their own checks. So that's my story.
So I want to make sure we hit a little of the, just hit the basics of Tech Coast Angels, like what size checks you're writing, because entrepreneurial audience wants to know how much money they can get. Mm-hmm. But then I want to like pepper you with questions on 99 Cents Only Stores.
Okay. Everything you want to know about 99 Cents Only Stores, but I was afraid to ask.
Yes.
Okay. Tech Coast is very active, and we see three or four companies twice a month. So, you know, it's almost 100 companies a year that we will screen at our meetings. And of course, the pre-screening, we screen out a lot. So we see lots of deals, but only a certain number get funded, like any VC or angel group would be. Usually members write checks, I would say on average about $25,000 each for someone to write their own check. And in any deal, it can vary. You could have four members, so you might have $100,000, or you could have a lot more folks putting in, and we've done rounds of $1.5 to $2 million. I think, but in general, I would say it's more several hundred thousand dollars would be typical if someone was to approach TCA. And, you know, we don't have a paid staff, so we're all volunteers. We have one person actually a shout out to Arash Sani, who is our director, executive director, and does everything for us, and we would not exist without him. But we do our own due diligence, and so we get really involved.
And if someone's raising like 250K from you guys, let's say, what is the total size of their round and what sort of valuation are they seeing? Or is it a note and it's a cap?
So we're open. We obviously prefer equity, but I know today, we all know today that companies love to do, you know, thanks to Y Combinator, they love to do safes and convertible notes. So the market is what the market is. So we prefer equity, but we're happy to do the others. And, you know, since we're angels, we're very comfortable getting in at the pre-seed and seed level. So we're used to companies with no revenue or very little traction, but we would prefer the valuations reflect that. You know, the valuations can vary, but, you know, typically we'll see companies coming in with pretty little traction, maybe with a convertible note, with a cap of, you know, somewhere between 3 to 5 million or something like that.
One of our listeners wrote in with a question, which is when we talk about one on four, like that might be a typical sort of thing that you'd see, something like someone raising $1 million on a $4 million pre-money. Someone said, what are you talking about when you say one on four or two on eight? It's just the amount they're raising and then the pre-money valuation.
Right. I would just say watch Shark Tank.
And oh, right.
They explain it very well for everyone. But I know when I first joined and TCA and when others come in, it always gets a little confusing with the pre and the post and doing the math. But, you know, it's pretty straightforward.
So if you want to be a savvy entrepreneur, just watch more Shark Tank. No, I mean, not at all. I'm just kidding.
Well, the only thing I'll say about Shark Tank is that you need to know your numbers. You need to know a lot about your business. You can't walk in and say, well, I have an accountant that does my numbers.
Right.
And it really is a turnoff, and you shouldn't ramble. You can watch in Shark Tank. You see people avoid questions. You see them ramble and not, and you see the expressions.
Yeah.
Or sometimes they're very vocal about what they don't like about the company. And so I think it's a good primer for understanding. But I'll say at Tech Coast Angels, we're not Shark Tank. We're Dolphin. We're like Dolphin Tank. We're Dolphin Tank. Because we know a lot of us are entrepreneurs and or have worked with entrepreneurs, and we know it's extremely tough to start a company, and there's no sense in tearing somebody down. And you know, we can choose whether to invest or not, but we want to be constructive with our comments and helpful.
I don't actually watch Shark Tank, but I imagine tearing people down makes for good television. Yeah,
probably.
And not necessarily for a great investing relationship.
No, but it is always crazy to me when I'm like, well, what was your revenue last year? Or some pretty obvious question. And people are like, well, I'm not exactly sure.
That's not good.
Wouldn't work on Shark Tank.
That's right.
I'm desperate to know more about the dollar.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, dollar only store.
No, 99 cents.
99 cents. Whatever, dollar.
No,
I round up in my head.
I read up a little, like 1 cent makes a big difference if you're doing low margin businesses, right? Or
if you're selling something for a dollar. And, you know, every penny is 1% of your revenue, right?
I apologize.
Yeah, that's all right.
Okay, good.
And how big was it when you joined, when you became an employee there?
So when I joined in late 91, we had about 20 stores. It might have been 22. And they were all within, very close to down, all in LA. I think the farthest store was Ontario, and that's Ontario, California, of course. Yeah. And we thought, boy, that is so far. It's like 40 miles from here. But over time we added stores in four states, and I think that's what gets to scaling a business. When we had 20 something stores all within like a 1 to 2 hour drive, our family and the key members of our management team, we could run out to fix any problem and we could be there. And so we had a model, I think, with, you know, you had the family, which was my father-in-law, Dave Gold, who was a retail genius. So it was kind of like a genius with 1,000 helpers kind of management structure. And we had to evolve because, you know, when you have stores in many states and the logistics and wanting to run and be a profitable business, we had to change a lot how we did it. And we had to learn how to bring people in from the outside who were professionals or had a lot of experience, and to bring in these folks without losing our entrepreneurial spirit, so to speak.
It sounds very analogous to what we see in startups, in tech startups as they grow. How do you go from the sort of one genius million helpers to a structure without breaking things?
Well, I've never seen a really great book on it, you know, or roadmap on it, but there are certain things that you have to be sensitive to it. I think the people coming in and the folks that are there have to be willing to communicate and listen to each other. Cause a lot of the problems I see is miscommunication, where someone says this and you heard that. And then you go off in your own direction, and then you come back and you're like, what did you do? And then there's really a lot of problems. So it really requires both sides to really kind of understand that they're going to be speaking different languages at first, and they have to slow down, and they have to really kind of, I mean, it's almost like, okay, I heard you. It's like someone that doesn't really speak English that well, and you say something to them and you want to make sure they understood what you said. So you say, please tell me what you heard me say, as opposed to just, yes, I'm going to do it. And they repeat it back and you're like, oh no, that's not what I said. So it's almost like you're speaking two different languages. And also, I think you really have to understand what the core values are of your business and understand what are the nice to have things you have and what are the must have things. So not everyone's going to come in. Most people that come in are not going to hit all your values, but you have certain core values you can't give up on, you know? So if one of your values is doing more with less, for example, if that's what you've decided, that's has to be, if you had someone that comes in from a big company, have used to having a really big budget, used to having a big staff, they may be brilliant, but they just don't want to get involved in that doing more with less kind of thing. They may be, as I said, really competent, but they could be a disaster at your company if it kind of takes away from that part of your culture that you think is important.
Yeah. So when we're talking about scale here, like how many stores, I don't have a good concept of what a big retail chain, how many stores that is.
So a typical dollar store that you may have seen probably does about $1 million a unit. And if you see little retail chains that are restaurants and so on, they probably do about $1 million. A grocery store probably does 25 to 50 million, just to give you a sense. A Home Depot is probably, and Target is probably 100 million,
in
50
revenue.
To 100 million in revenue
a year.
Per store. A big successful one. So 99 cents only stores, we average $5 million a store. And our average size store was a little under 20,000 square feet. So it's much smaller than a supermarket, but much bigger than like a little, like a little like fast food restaurant thing. And so, which at the time we were doing more per revenue, more per square foot than any other dollar store, you know, that was around, and as much as many deep discount stores. So that's just to give you an idea in terms of the size of the store. We had, when I left, we had around 330 stores. We were doing about $1.6 billion in sales, roughly. And when we did our buyout, we did the buyout for $1.6 billion. So it worked out that it was about one time sales at the buyout. And our EBITDA was 150-something million, so it was about 9 times EBITDA, roughly, a little over 9 times EBITDA. So those are 2012 prices. I don't know what happens now, but that, just to give you a sense of scale.
No, I'm super interested in, like, in a store, how many brands, or how do you, like, that would be how I would think about it, is how many brands rather than how many SKUs, but like how much is in a store?
So it really, again, depends on the type of retail outfit. So for 99 cents only stores, one thing that made us very unique versus almost all the retailers, even discount retailers, is that we bought closeouts, one-time special buys. So you could think of like a new and improved item that didn't make it, or the item that it replaced that the manufacturer, the CPG company, is getting rid of, or it could be a seasonal type item. You know, it could be an item that's close to its expiration date but has not hit it. So let's just say it's got, you know, 2 months to go, and the supermarkets don't want to buy it unless it has 5 months to go. There could be many reasons why. Sometimes manufacturers want to make their quarterly numbers. They're big public companies. So they just say, okay, we have to hit $1 billion in sales by the end of December. So let's go with some special promotions. But the deal is, we have to find a company that can take it in right now. And so we were the ultimate in flexibility when we bought from manufacturers. We were, whatever they wanted to do, we would do it, as long as we could get a low net price. And there's many other things that grocery stores and other things do that bring the prices up for the consumer. But we were what's called a dead net customer, where we didn't charge any allowances. It's getting into too much detail.
No, it's interesting.
But grocery stores will charge so if you're an investor, an angel investor in a consumer goods company, someone's coming up with a new kind of energy bar and they want to get on the shelves of Ralph's, the supermarkets will charge a slotting allowance. And you'll have to pay them to put your product on their shelf. Or they may say, you have to pay us an advertising allowances. When they were the only game in town, they could completely get away with it. And it was really expensive to get shelf space. It still is. But now there's some other markets that, you know, a deep discount operation won't charge. We just want to get the lowest price. And, you know, maybe a Whole Foods, I don't know if they charge. They may now. But it used to be they didn't. And they would give breaks to smaller companies. But I don't know what they do now. But so those are the kind of things that happen in our business, and it makes it hard for a new brand to get started.
But if I am a new brand, can I get onto your shelves? Like, what do you look for? Do you look for me being in the mom and pop stores, or how do I, or is it just a relationship business? Or,
well, I don't know if you're a new brand, you would want to get directly onto the 99 cents only store shelves, because we're only paying a certain amount if we could sell it for 99 cents. But we did work with a number of companies to help them level out their production. So if you're producing a tremendous amount in these months of the year or this time of the month, and you want to keep the line moving, it just, you know, you can produce for a lot less. We could say, whenever you produce it, whatever month of the year, we will take it, as long as we can buy it for, say, 65 cents. And we're going to sell it for 99. And, you know, it may sell for $1.59 somewhere else. But we're completely flexible.
When I think of a 99 cents store, I don't think high tech. In the in the front, they don't look very techy. In the back of the operation, when you're figuring out how to manage all these margins, were you using a lot of tech?
When we started out, we were not using a lot of tech. In fact, my brother-in-law, he kind of brought tech with him. He graduated from Berkeley. Another brother-in-law was a math major at UCLA. And those two guys understood computers. They wrote the first program. They used a Radio Shack computer, which day we got rid of those, we threw them off the roof of the building. Nice. But they built the first system. And it was a little bit of kind of like an allocation system. And how do you allocate product to stores? Because if you think about a company that is buying closeouts, and we never know what we're going to get. So a retailer that doesn't buy closeouts knows what they're going to buy, and they have it planned out, and they have planners and allocators, and they say, okay, we know we're going to get 2,000 cases of this, and we know this, and they know weeks in advance, if not more. So they'll say, this is how much is going to go to everyone, get ready, and this is exactly how we want the shelf to look in the store, and they'll do a planogram. It's all really nicely done, and the person in the store gets the picture, it arrives on this day, and it's all done. Now, they don't know how fast things are going to sell and so on, and you have to replenish, and that's a different issue. But for us, 50% of our merchandise were these special deals that we never knew when we're going to get. And when we got them, especially if they were short-coded, in other words, they got a month or 2 months to go to expiration, like salad dressing, that's going to be expiring next month. We got to, we're now become the craft French dressing store. So so the managers would have to figure out where to put it. Well, where does dressing go? It goes in the section with other dressings.
Unless.
And so they come out and like, here's the section. It's completely full. Now they have to work this into it and move bottles around. And the next day, another dressing appears they didn't know about. And also we have to decide how much to send them. So when we had a small number of stores, we could figure it out and we could do it. We had a system. It was kind of rudimentary. And then we automated it, and it was still rudimentary from that point of view, but it worked for us. And then we kind of forced it to work. We put band-aids on it. And then when we opened up stores in other states, what we had did not work at all. And we learned the hard way. So we talked about scaling. We opened for a retail business, and I imagine other businesses go through this, the key issues you have to figure out to be able to successfully scale. For us in retail, when you have one distribution center, and that's one distribution center, one distribution point that's supplying all the stores, it's like a hub with many spokes, that's one model. But when you have stores that are now, and say for us in Texas, which were thousands of miles away from California, it was too expensive to send it from California because the truck driver can't get there in one day. And there's many other issues that make it cost prohibitive. So we had a separate distribution center. And so it's kind of going for people that have kids, going from one kid to two kids. You can't parent the same way. And so now you have two kids. So now you have to really do it a different way. And so the logistics we needed were different, and the processes we needed, we had to improve. And so we had we really became much more sophisticated. And as I said, we made many mistakes, and we learned the hard way. We'd have stores that looked empty. They just didn't get replenished that right. Because even though that the warehouse was close by in Texas to the Texas stores, that warehouse was out of the product because we allocated it wrong. Because when we bought it, we had to send some to California, some to Texas, and then we had to replenish. So anyways, too much detail. But yes, we became quite sophisticated from a tech point of view, and that happened over the years. I was there with my brothers-in-law and the rest of our team, and we had some very strong people in IT, and it worked well for us.
I think it's such an important lesson that with a business that sounds very different than the tech startups that we talk to most of the time, culture was still such a key issue. When did you start even thinking about that? And did you, when you came to the company, was there already a culture that was enshrined somehow?
So, I had an engineering background. So when people talked about, okay, the culture is so important, and then I was kind of finance background, I was like, yeah, okay. I just didn't give it much credence until I needed to, we grew to a point where we kind of lost our culture. And I always just assumed that if the leaders of the organization, demonstrate the culture in their actions, they walk the walk, then it would translate to the rest of the organization. And it worked that way in the beginning when we had a small number of stores and everyone knew us. And we did have a culture, and it was set from my father-in-law, as I said, Dave Gold, who started the company, and he had certain things that he deeply believed in. I'll give you an example of one. He would say, run your business, your department, like you'd run your household. So when you leave your house, if the light's on, you're going away, you're leaving for work, you're going to turn the lights off. No one has to really teach you that, or maybe your mom taught you when you were 5 years old. But there's certain basic things, you know, this is your business. This is your household. So we'd have, he had a lot of basic things like that, you know, and he would say that he was, you know, our original CEO, and he would say, I'm not the CEO, the customer's the CEO. So just basic things that drilled into us and how, you know, we should act at the company. We worked hard, we did more with less. And so as we grew, the point of this story is that as we grew, we found that we would go to stores and they didn't really know what our culture was. Stores that were thousands of miles away and managers that didn't understand. It's impossible for me as the CEO and the rest of our team to get to every store. Even in 1 year, it would be very difficult to do it. I wouldn't have any time to do anything else. And so we had a point where our results started to go downhill as a public company, which, by the way, is very embarrassing. And you're very public, you're a giant fishbowl, and you're getting yelled at on conference calls. But they were right. And we made our mistakes, but it was very public. And so we pulled back in the sense that we brought the management team together and we talked about the company's core values.
So just let me interrupt you for a second. So the first sign you had that your culture was breaking was actually way at the bottom line. Like, did you see it coming before that, before the business started breaking?
I saw it in the sense that just behaviors going to, when I would visit stores, I would always do surprise visits. I didn't announce I was coming. There's some retailers where when the boss comes, everyone knows it. Then you don't see reality. So I would always, you know, whenever I was, I'd take surprise visits and go in and I would see things I didn't like. But, you know, at first I attributed to, okay, this is probably a poor manager or poor. But then I would see it in other parts of the company. Like, they weren't really acting the way I would act. But our company was doing great. Then over time, the results started to slip. Whether it was we weren't fighting for the best price as much as we used to with the manufacturers, or shrinkage was going up, which is theft, or sales were not increasing as much as we like. Just a number of things, we started to see it. And it also was combined. It was kind of a perfect storm because it worked with our growth. And we also had issues where we made mistakes as we expanded to this thing where we had stores in other states and two distribution centers and didn't have a strong process and system. So at first I thought, well, we got to improve our process, our tech, our systems, but I really didn't focus on the culture as much as I should have. And because I just said, I'm a perfect example of the good part of our culture. I walk the walk, and everyone here that I'm working with here in this small group, we're walking the walk, but they didn't see us. And what I learned is that if you have any person if you have a chain of command, if there's one weak link in that, if someone is not reflecting that culture, it doesn't matter if six people above them or their direct boss reflects it perfectly, that person, everyone below them just sees their boss and says, well, this is how the company is. So it was really a lesson for me. And it took a while. We got together, we went through what are our core values? We worked, and you know, we finally came up with them and we put them on the back of our business cards. I may still have an old business card in my wallet. I don't know. That still has them, but we put them up. We had to make changes in some senior management positions because they didn't really reflect the core values. And but for most people, we gave them a chance to really embrace them. And I knew it was right when I walked around after it was up, and a few people came up to me. And I mean, this is going to sound so hokey, guys, but you know, people came up that had been in the company a while, that were good employees and strong, competent people, and they had like tears in their eyes, and they said, "This is exactly what the company means to me," you know, literally. And so I knew we hit it right, and I credit that. I mean, we put good systems in place. We made sure, you know, we changed out if it was people that had been there a long time or new people, just people in the wrong positions, we made changes. But I think those core values helped us tremendously by really codifying them and really making people aware of them and making people believe that if someone didn't reflect the core values, I mean, they could do whatever they want at home, but at our company, they needed to act out these core values. Sorry, but you asked the question that resonated with me. So.
It's good. So without sounding negative, when you got bought, so it was a PE buyout, did any of that stay in place, or do you have lessons on that?
So we did a buyout, and we partnered with the PE firm. So it wasn't that they, so, you know, during the process of the buyout, which was in January 2012, it closed. Our family sold about 80% of our equity and 20% we rolled into the new company. Since I've been gone, they are on their, I think, sixth CEO since I left, but some of them were interims. Mm. And they seem to have someone who seems pretty good right now, and I hope that this person does great. I said that we had rolled our 20% into the company, and so after we left, within a year of that leaving, by late 2013, we sold our remaining piece back to the private equity firm. So for six years now, we haven't been involved. We have no equity. The only thing is I still shop there. Yeah. So I love the stores, and I think the stores are still a lot of fun. Look, everyone likes to get a bargain, right? Everyone likes, like, this great deal I got. So the best thing was when someone gets a great deal, they go home, they tell their neighbors or friends, look what I got, and that word of mouth is fantastic and, you know, helps the business too.
How about as an investor, when you look at consumer goods?
So the things I would look at is what I would say, if you look at any package, just think about, just put yourself in the eyes of a consumer or a customer. You walk down an aisle of a store, how much time are you going to spend looking at every single package? I mean, you just see it very briefly. So the call outs, which is, you know, what's on the label. Like, what does this say?
He's picking up a water. It says liquid death. Just kidding. Just kidding.
Yes.
Crystal geyser.
Yeah. It says, I mean, the only thing I see natural, I see spring water, but, you know, but maybe that's a bad example, but that's what they choose to call out. Right. And so the call outs in the package are really important. You only have so much space on your label. And so sometimes you see companies that are, you know, maybe they have high protein and they think that's really important, but you have to look on the back to see that they have a lot of protein. Mm. So we used to see so many mistakes because we bought closeouts. Mm-hmm. So we became very good at saying, oh, that we've seen that before, that won't work.
What about distribution? Like, how do I, if I'm trying to get something onto shelves, where do I start? Do I start with the mom and pop, like, relationships, like the small corner store? Or how do I, depending, I guess, on what I'm selling, but how do I start to get people buying my stuff?
Well, you got to go to the retailers and you got to make appointments. You have to be aggressive in a good way. You can't be intimidated. You need to go in there. Most retailers, the buyers at these retail companies, they like it when the CEO or founder of a company comes in. You know, they feel a little bit, you know, they like that. It's a good thing. And if you come in and you have passion about your product and you can convince them, that's a way to at least get a trial. And you may say, look, Whole Foods, I mean, obviously you're not going to, I'd love you to put me in all your stores, but let me try out in a couple stores. Let's just see how it does. Now, if they happen to say, okay, we'll try out in a couple stores, you better make sure that you go to those stores and make sure that someone didn't, like, accidentally put, like, another display, a floor display in front, or that it looks nice. The Whole Foods buyer doesn't need to know that you're going in and fixing it up. Now, or you can go in and buy all the products off the shelf and to tell the Whole Foods buyer, look, it sold like crazy. Hmm. Now, I'm not saying to do that.
Have things changed with the prevalence of direct consumer CPG?
Yeah, it's changed retail 100%. So certain items, people just would rather buy online. Certain, you know, I think deep discount stores still have an advantage in that the pricing brings people to the stores. There are stores, I wouldn't call them deep discount, but there are stores that have certain, an intangible element where it's not a chore to go to the store. It's more fun, like a Trader Joe's, or some people love Costco, where it may be a chore to get there and find parking in a Trader Joe's parking lot. But once you're in the store, it's an enjoyable experience. But nobody says, I love to go to CVS. So,
fortunately, CVS isn't a sponsor. But what I was sort of more asking was for a CPG, a new CPG company, has it become a necessity for them to prove themselves out in a direct way before they come to retailers?
Yeah, I think you can go either way. I don't think it's a necessity to be able to say that I can show I got some traction online, or I don't think it's a necessity to say I sell it online. I mean, certain retailers might be delighted that they're selling something in their store that someone can't buy online. Mm-hmm. The other hand, I do think that I don't think there's any retailers out there at this point anymore would say, I'm not going to buy it if it's online, only if I could have it in my store. So I think it can go both ways. I don't think it's a necessity. I don't think it's, I think it would probably just be viewed as a positive if you can show, you know, it's really selling great and you want to get it to your stores. I do think that with many kind of products, it's difficult for somebody to get to all the retailers. So you, many times they hire a distributor or a broker, depends on which line, and there's different brokers out there or manufacturers reps that you can hire. The thing you got to make sure though, when you hire them, is that are they carrying any lines that are competing lines? And then you have to understand what incentive is there for them to sell your product when they're coming in and they have 50 other items that they're in front of the buyer from Ralph's. And they said, I carry these 50 items. You got to realize the buyer from Ralph's only going to spend so much time in front of that with that person. So you may be the 38th item they bring up. So so that's why I always would say, make sure you go with the broker. In other words, make sure the founder or the co-founder or the head of sales
goes with
the broker on some trips. And you can see them, see what they do, watch how they do it. And then, of course, it's good to have you there as a backup, too. They can say, here's the founder with me.
Okay, maybe we have to get off this, but wait, if I go to a buyer, let's say I'm not with a broker right now, what am I selling the buyer on? Like, do they care about the cost? They care about how well it fits in with the rest of their inventory? Or like, what do I need to pitch them on?
Well, yes and yes to both things. They do care about the cost. They care about how it fits in with what they carry, and they care about how it's going to sell, probably most of all, along with the cost. So those are all things. But you know, it's very helpful before you go to a potential customer, which would be a retail chain, for example, you walk their stores. And so you can come in and say, you know, I see that you really have a strong section in this area, and I think my product will bring this into that section, or will highlight this, or you're trying to appeal to millennials. My product really hits that target market. So, I mean, that's very helpful, I think.
Great. Okay, we've got to talk some more about TCA. I mean, I did have basic questions that keep coming up that I was just going to pepper you with. Things like in a priced seed round. So, you know, you're looking at these rounds. What do you think is dilution for the founders that they should be expecting to have before their Series A? Or, and related to that is option pools. Like, what do you think is a good option pool for a seed round?
We saw a company recently where it was a seed round and they're raising $1 million and it's a $2 million pre-money valuation. So right away, they're giving up 1/3. And
not to mention the option pool.
I didn't even ask about the option pool, but there's the option pool. And then they said they're going to need to raise $10 million down the road. So nobody wants to invest in a company where, as you know, the people doing the actual work and the visionaries behind it have very little equity. So it's... So I think founders have to be very careful not to give away too much to begin. And I think as investors, you're deceiving yourself if you think, I got a great deal, I own so much of this company, and you have founders that at some point will wake up and say, I hardly own any of this company. So I think that is a critical thing it's really bad for investors to get greedy from that point of view. It would just hurt themselves.
Yeah, and if the founders don't come to that conclusion, maybe a downstream investor will and will make corrections to the cap table before they even
put
in
their
money. Right,
they make corrections to the cap table. If the angels have decided, we've put enough money in, we're happy to have this VC come in, and the VC says the founders don't have enough equity, they're not going to say, okay, founders, give us some of your equity to get more equity. No, they're going to take it from the existing investors. So, you know, probably many angels have seen that happen, and it makes sense why. So, and in terms of the option pool, I know a lot of folks say 10%, but I like to see 15 or maybe even 20.
And that should get you like the 10 to 20% option pool, whatever it is, should get you your next 10 to 20 hires.
You know, I've numbers all over the board, but I think like 1 to 3% is a lot of equity to give up, you know. But of course, if you're bringing in someone who's going to be kind of on the same level as the founder, that's a different story.
I still would have said usually less than 1%.
Yeah.
But interesting. Okay. Other things that we really need to cover because we are running out of time.
You know, I would just say that that if they come in, they should be prepared to have, like, they just need to have the basics. We'll tell anyone presenting, we'll give them a sample template of what the pitch deck should look like. So we try to be very helpful with the entrepreneurs so they, when they come in, they can be ready for our pre-screening committee and so on.
That's great.
I can give you a sense how quick the process goes for entrepreneurs if you want, or how fast they can expect funding or no.
Sure.
So from the time they present to our meeting, so they go through, they apply online, then we'll pre-screen them in like a 10-minute kind of webinar type thing with a pre-screening committee. If they pass that, Then they'll come to what we call a screening meeting, which is the meeting where three or four companies present. If they pass that, then we'll go to a due diligence meeting. And then the timing from when they present to us at the screening meeting to when they can expect a check, we try to get that done within 5 weeks.
It sounds great. Well, I hope you keep it up, keep funding great entrepreneurs. And we really appreciate that you took the time to come visit us here today and be on the podcast.
It's my pleasure.